Hey, Math Teacher Lounge fans, welcome back to Math Teacher Lounge. I'm Dan Meyer.
And I'm Bethany Lockhart Johnson.
And today I'm thrilled. We have one of my oldest, dearest colleagues from the internet community of math teachers. We have Fawn Nguyen with us. Fawn, give a wave, Fawn, to the camera, would you? Cool. Fawn has been a teacher for a very long time. Like, she is someone who could have left the classroom at any point and taken any number of jobs in the math teaching universe. But I've always admired that Fawn has taught kids for a very long time. And that has given her, in my view, just a lot of clarity on what is important to her about students. I've seen like her not get upset or obsessed with certain kinds of small niche issues that a lot of us get a lot of us down in the classroom sometimes. And she's maintained a laser focus on, among many other things, problem solving as a virtue in mathematics classrooms. So please welcome Fawn to our show. Fawn, thanks so much for being here.
Hey, thank you so much. Thank you. I'm so excited and honored that you guys invited me for this, Bethany and Yay. Dan.
Thank you for being here.
Yeah, I love you, Bethany. Dan, I can tolerate, but I love you. And
I really worked myself up there on that complimentary opening for you, and that's how you get me back here. Okay. Problem solving is fully on the consciousness of math teachers. Every math teacher knows that they need to say, problem solving. Yes, love it. Do it. I dig it. But even so, I feel like it's become kind of a buzzword. Like, it's not always obvious like what that means, or am I doing problem solving really? So we're curious, as someone who is a problem solving expert, who is, you know, asked all over the world to like talk about problem solving, like, how do I know if I'm doing problem solving in my classroom?
This is not my definition of it, but nor am I an expert, by the way, Dan, thank you. But I try really, really hard and to work on it. My definition, or it's not my definition, but I like it because it's short and honest, is problem solving is what we do when we don't know what to do. And so with that mind frame, I'm hoping teachers think more about what their task, because I think it gets mislabeled a lot as to what is problem solving. If the kids already know what to do, there's a solution path, then it's not problem solving.
Yeah. So what are examples then? Like an example of like, I might call something problem solving, but like it fails that particular definition you just proposed there. Very short, very honest definition.
It needs to have constraint and contradiction to what the kids think naturally. It should become as a surprise. There's an element of surprise in it. There's tension.
Maybe like if there's harder numbers or like, you know, decimals or fractions in the same kind of procedure. I can feel myself like thinking, yeah, this is hard. This is problem solving. Problem solving equals hard. But we already know what to do.
Or just word problems. That's the most common thing. As soon as it just has words attached to the math, it becomes a problem solving. But that's just coding it. To me, that's just coding it with words. Wrapping it around, it doesn't mean anything until we read through and see if it's, you know, there's true problem solving in it.
Like, what's the moment that it becomes problem solving in the way that you envision it?
I think, well, there's the bigger problem solving of really bringing a task, I want to call it left field. It just, we rarely ever see it in the regular coursework, but it can also be problem solving if we just take what we expect the children to do at the end of the unit. How about we front load that? To me, that's also problem solving. So that, and I'm trying to encourage teachers to do that last problem first. The task writers put more thought, not that they don't do the rest of it, but, you know, this is a special one because they labeled it challenge or enrichment or are you ready for more? I've seen those. And so it is this really special problem. And I would love for us to think about do that first. Because my biggest fear is that because it comes at the end, that not all the children are involved. And so that to me is the saddest part, is because we might not get to it, right? In mathematics, we always think, okay, well, let's do these problems and then we don't have time for the rest. But I think that's your richest task right there, is at the very end. So why don't we front load it, start it? And it's okay if, of course, it's okay that we don't all get it, but the exposure to all students is so important. Talk about, equity, talk about that everybody gets the same thing. If everyone dug into that first one with everybody's collaboration and we get to share that, And then we leave it because, yeah, okay, now we learn more of the other stuff, right? That hopefully support. And then we can go back. And now everybody had a chance to go get into it. And then we can come back to it. As many problems, we need to go back to it.
And that feels so powerful because it feels like it's, as a teacher, I'm thinking it would also inform my work, how I approach the unit and how I approach the next steps, right? Like what kind of work would we be doing? Like if I allow it to change the way that I approach the unit.
Yeah, what you're describing is so powerful and really asks a lot of the task designers as well, I think. Like there are problem solving tasks that like really require like abstract knowledge of the way formulas and variables fit together. And what I love about like what Amplify is doing with their problem solving, what you're helping them do is that they start with a true low floor that like can draw in every student, and they might get stuck in different places. That's fine, but everyone has a way in. That's exciting.
It's a big deal for me to have this opportunity and this trust to integrate problem solving into the curriculum, make it intentional. It's difficult to implement. It is, to be honest, because for me, what is a good task? This is makes one of my four criteria. One is it is non-routine. It is simply stated. That's like your low floor, and then has multiple solutions. And the fourth, this makes it because that the teacher enjoys solving it. And so you have to enjoy solving it to bring it, because so that way I can say to my kids, this is my gift. It really is, because, you know, I had so much fun and joy, and I appreciate the struggle. And I want to illustrate an example. For example, let's say Dan and I are classmates, and I know that Dan gets A's on his test, and the lowest score he ever got was an 89%. I, on the other hand, just sitting right next to him, I average D. I have a D average on everything. While Bethany, our amazing and wonderful teacher, brings in a problem. And when she brings it in, she says, I worked on this problem. I found this problem. I worked on it and I struggled with it. And it was amazing. I enjoyed it so much. I'm sharing it with you. And all of a sudden, it's like, okay. And I'm sitting there, right? My teacher loves this problem so much. She's bringing it in to share with us. And now all of a sudden, and it's not, and I know she only gives us non-routine. When she talks about problem solving, it's non-routine. So it's not directly tied to the textbook that I've been struggling with. Okay, so this is, it gives me a chance. It gives me a chance to contribute, to think differently. And now suddenly I look forward to working with Dan, because in this space, in this problem solving space, Dan is no longer Mr. Know-it-all. And so and that's what I mean by I've been saying this for 100 times, and I will not stop saying it, which is problem solving levels the playing field. Our world is filled with unsolved problems. Are you kidding me? Right? We look around us. We have so many things that are not solvable, or people are working on it. And yet in mathematics, what happens? The bell rings, we start and end, we solve everything during that time, and we leave. And that's, yeah, no, I know we need to wrestle with problems.
Fawn Nguyen, thank you so much for your sharing your abundant enthusiasm for not just problem solving, but also teachers and students and the world. It's all so evident.
You can find us at MTL Show on Twitter, or you can head on over to Facebook and check out more information, more conversations at the Math Teacher Lounge Facebook group. We're so excited that you joined us, and we hope you tune in next time for even more conversation with Fawn Nguyen. Thank you so much.